jump in.
See if I'm on. All right. Let's see if I'm turned on here. I don't know. I think so. Yeah. All right. So it's 5:43. There's at least a group of people that need to make a train and a plane. So the goal is to be done at exactly at 6. So my name's Mike Janke. Along with Bob Ackerman, I'm one of the co-founders of DataTribe. We're a very weird beast. So what this is about is a very weird, unique, effective model, something you've probably never seen on cyber investing, but building cyber companies. My background is also very weird. I'm a former member of SEAL Team 6, then in the intelligence community, and a five-time CEO of cyber companies. The latest was Silent Circle and Black Phone with Phil Zimmerman, the creator of PGP, and Black Phone, and as well as Apple's chief cryptographer, John Calas. So let me get into the weirdness, and I think you'll understand what we're doing here. If my clicker actually responds. Yep, we're there. We go. So I'm not going to belabor this one really a lot. There's been a change in the investing ecosystem. A lot of you heard Bob on the panel. He's been 22 years on Sand Hill Road, cyber investor, built up a real large cyber. But in the last 3 years, things have changed. What I'll call the big 12 venture firms in Silicon Valley have consolidated funds now. $1 billion, $1.7 billion, $2 billion, $2.3 billion. So what's happening is to spend that much money at that pace, they're basically pushed themselves out of the A rounds. When I mean A rounds, I mean between 5 and 12 million A rounds. So angels have taken up a lot of that, as much as they can. And then you have incubators that have a very different model. What we did is we did something very weird. So me and Bob's other co-founder is former CIA, was in charge of all the technology, came out as a CEO with his brother from Fort Meade, created a technology that had been deployed inside the Five Eye Nations. Bob and I got with him, added support, sold it to Hortonworks in 6 months for $42 million with five members on the team. Now, it's not a huge exit in terms of Silicon Valley, but it proved a point on this kind of weird cyber investing. So what we do is we partner with the Four Eye Nations. If you know the Five Eyes, US, UK, Canada, Australia, New Zealand. Well, not much comes out of New Zealand. They use a lot of the other ones. We work with these organizations. We don't do tech transfer. We have no government money in us at all. It's all corporate, seven corporations, as well as 25 very prominent Silicon Valley operators that the money goes in. We're not SEC regulated. We have an operating fund. We're a company. We have an OPEX. So what we do is we look at over the horizon technology inside the Intel. When I mean Intel, I mean Canada CSE, I mean JSOC, I mean Australia's version of the NSA, GCHQ, Sandia Labs, Cybercom, CIA, IARPA, John Hopkins Applied Research, really, really interesting areas. And we look at technology that has been deployed in use to solve a problem that something commercially would not solve. And what we do is we interact, and those teams that are in charge of it or that built it, we bring them out when they're ready, move them into DataTribe, actually move them in. We provide $1.5 million, sometimes $2 million in seed right out of the gates. They move into our facility. We do four companies at a time. We have a senior team of 12 people. By way of example, Jay Emanuel, chief architect at Incutel. Previous to that, he sold two companies in the Valley. Each of our team like that has time in the Intel agency, but also built cyber companies in Exidem. So they speak both languages. Some of them are in the Valley, and we mash them here. It's a very unique model. It is heavy lifting. We work 10, 12 hours a day heavy lifting with these companies, product management, product market fit. We give you your first branding and marketing. We introduce you to your new sales and lead generating, right? We don't say, hey, what do you think? We actually co-build these companies. But the way we invest is like everybody else does. What's your valuation? Here's $1.5 million, here's $1.7 million. We don't take anything extra at all. Just a blank, simple term sheet that moves on to A. But then we'll put up to another $1.5 million to $4 million in your A. And a lot of the other venture firms that we call friends and family kind of wait under the feed chute 12, 14 months later, and they kind of compete to fill out the rest of the A round for these startups. The cool part is, because of our corporate venture partners, with our side letter with them, when we bring startups in, they immediately begin an OODO loop, testing the software, UI, UX, install, would you use it, what do you need to use it? So by the time they come out in 12 or 15 months, they already have customers, they have use case in a perfect world. Now, location matters. We have an office in Palo Alto, but our main office is in Fulton, Maryland. We are 3 miles from Fort Meade, from Cybercom, CIA, National Geospatial, and about 4 other agencies. In this area, there are 3 times more cyber engineers than the rest of the country, and guess what? Also Canada combined. But 1/14 of the investment money and 0 ecosystem. You can't walk through the valley, get a coffee, without running into a new co-founder, a chief marketing officer, head of sales. That ecosystem is there. It's not, so we provide it. In my previous life in the SEAL teams, as an analogy, there are 2 ways to get through a minefield. The first, which I don't recommend, is by Braille. And that's usually the startup way you have to do it. The second is you get a map and help. And we make it an unfair fight. So when we look at some of the numbers of the stuff we see, so by way of example, in 2016, we saw 206 technologies and teams. We chose 4. What we see out there in what we'll call the standard cyber investing realm, before, you know, with Bob having done Allegis Capital for 22 years, when I got out of building and running companies, I invested myself. And you have these issues that relate. Enterprise sales, product management, how do you get them pilots that turn into customers? Product market fit. Are you, you know, a solution looking for a problem? Are you a feature? So what we decided is, what if you could take a dozen, 10 of some of the most experienced people, and they worked 8 to 10 hours a day with that amazing team coming out of Fort Meade or GCHQ with this over-the-horizon technology? And I know it sounds like hyperbole, but the stuff that we continue to work on is generally 3 to 4 generations ahead of what's out there. Typically, if you're in venture, as a lot of people are, or actually you heard the CISOs here, you know, you look at something and you go, okay, thanks for the pitch. You're telling me your product is 10% less sugar and 25% less fat than all the other 11 well-funded startups. That's not enough. 50% of the time, the best technology doesn't win. Funding, marketing, splash, the team, who helped them get their customers, you know, early on, traction. And that's not a sad thing to say, it's truism, right, in a lot of the industry. So when you see these teams that are working on nation state stuff that they developed, and there's a reason why only about 10% of this stuff inside the cutting edge agencies is 3 to 4 generations ahead of what's out commercial. About 80% of the time, they use COTS, commercial off the shelf. Another 10% of the time, they use commercial off the shelf tweaked. Here's Splunk, here's $50 million, change Splunk to do X, Y, and Z, okay? And then there's a 10% where they spend the hundreds of billions of dollars of R&D because nothing else out there can solve the problem. You think Google and Amazon have the big pipe? Theirs is decent size, Compared to the Intel agencies, not even close. Commercial products, some of them like Hadoop, they break at scale on these massive pipes. So big data is one area they're ahead. Offensive, right? But here's the interesting part. If you have a offensive capability that's three or four generations ahead of your enemies, it also means you have a defensive capability because you reverse engineer that, right? If you can do something that nobody else can do or they don't know you can do, now you also know how to secure against it because you figured out the attack vector. There are huge, huge advancements, and obviously when you talk some of these encryption, right? Homomorphic encryption was a 20-year holy grail. Research universities, IBM, Microsoft, Cambridge, and Berkeley, and Department of Energy, and everybody has been working on it. Homomorphic encryption is the holy grail idea that you could take your nation state's most secrets of secrets, the formula to Coca-Cola, if you're a corporation, the plans to the F-35 Joint Strike Fighter, as an example, and encrypt it to whatever you think is bomb-proof encryption, 256, 512, whatever your religion is on encryption. Encrypt that data. You can even throw it up in the Chinese military cloud. Let them bang on it. Now, with homomorphic encryption, you can access it, query it, run analytics against it, and guess what? It's never decrypted. Right? So now you can get the idea of why that's kind of the holy grail, right? I mean, how is that possible? So for 20 years, a lot of people have been working on this. Obviously, the Intel agencies for a little bit longer than that. And recently, about 2 years ago, there was a breakthrough. In fact, the world didn't even know about it because it was deployed at a certain intelligence agency, ours. They had solved it. We took that team out. They came out, did a startup, the seven people in that team, and within 4 months, just in 4 months in being a startup, they finished as a finalist at the RSA sandbox. Okay, they don't even know what a cap table is in 4 months. But that's how disruptive the technologies can be inside. Now, there's a little thing called execution in building a company. Having the best, coolest thing doesn't mean you're going to be successful and have a great exit. So that's where DataTribe comes in. They're moved in. But these type of big, over-the-horizon, tectonic plate-shifting things, some of them will work, some of them won't, right? The road is littered with really great breakthroughs that never become a mainstream cyber product. So when we observe most of the startups that we see, both in the Valley and elsewhere, these are the key areas, and there's several more, don't get me wrong. You know, there's other areas, branding, marketing, understanding, you know, early OODU loop to refine your product so you constrain, burn to learn. That is 75% of the reason why most cybersecurity startups fail. You may be a really cool guy and gal, really, really smart, you got a good idea. Somebody gives them a check, $1 million. 90% of the time, that check comes with, let me know what you need, all I need is a quarterly report, good luck, right? There's your minefield without a map. They don't know what they don't know. Even if you're a four-time CEO, you got a lot figured out, but if you're developing something in a different area, a lot of the roadblocks of support are the same. So we took a very weird approach. We will take the over-the-horizon technologies. We will add an amazing support team around them. So in the Virginia, DC, Maryland area, in 2015, the average seed round was $377K. The average seed round in Silicon Valley, $1.22 million. Whew, right? In that area, you could probably get a couple dentists to write you a couple $100,000 check. It's extremely hard to build a cybersecurity startup with that amount of funding. Worse, there's no ecosystem. Right? Repeat CEOs, repeat chief marketing officers that do commercial. So let me give you some numbers. The Beltway, we call it, in a survey in 2016 had 648 cyber companies. 11 of them did commercial products. The rest were services back to the government, right? 11. Now, in the Valley, Silicon Valley had 117 cybersecurity companies, okay? All of them were product. Only four were services. So that disparity. But if you look at the sheer volume, geez, 646 in Northern Virginia, DC, and Maryland. Almost six times, it is six times, what was in the Valley. But you could see the disparity on who and how their business model is. So location, and you'll hear a thousand ways. I think the closest thing to us is probably Team8 out of Israel. They draw their technology out of Unit 8200, their version of the NSA. But it's a little different model. They pretty much own the whole startup, right? They took a huge fund, they own the startup. Ours is very different. Doesn't mean it's the right way. It's just a very, very different way of trying to show up to a knife fight with a bazooka, right? You de-risk it as much as you can by providing the support that they would never be able to get in the expertise. And they move in-house, all four startups, and they are literally shepherded through every phase of it. It's tremendous heavy lifting, and it doesn't mean everything you do is going to be a blast. We'll have a few, they did all right type of things, and a few that'll crash. It's just numbers. But there are very, very different approaches and models in different areas. And you have to look at things in the context. Everybody wants to talk about where is it going. So one of our startups is focused in, you heard this panel up here, industrial Internet of Things, or industrial control systems, ICS, power plants, grid, so forth. One of our startups is probably the most prominent, fastest growing ICS company in the world, and they're probably around a year old, that came out of Fort Meade. Those areas are extremely, extremely hot and of priority, but it doesn't mean that it's going to be the next big thing, right? It doesn't mean that you've built the next FireEye simply because you have smart people in an industry. So, there's a lot of things called execution and timing and things that are outside of an investor's control, right? You can prognosticate all you want, but show me some person who actually can predict timing of a market, when a market and a product will fit up, and over the horizon. Anybody who tells you they can, I would probably run the other way. A lot of interesting models out there, really, really smart cyber investing firms that focus on cyber out there. But most of them have cyber as part of their portfolio. We have 142 investments from sexting apps to food delivery, and yes, we do cyber. But cyber is unique in that it requires a lot of heavy lifting and heavy touch to be successful. It's just the way that is. So there are a lot of different models out there. You heard the earlier panel on government talking about why can't the US government intel agencies help Target and Ford and all? It's not in their charter. They don't do that. Is there going to be a private-public partnership? Yeah, sure, right? So what we do is we try to foment that. We're pulling arguably some of the top over-the-horizon technologies out and commercializing it. It's one way. It's a drop in the bucket, but it's one way where you can commercialize over-the-horizon stuff that gets into the enterprise markets. That's it. I went a minute over. Thanks, enjoy the show. Let's get out of here. I'll leave this with you.